In this example, we will try to apply the fast method to draw the internal forces diagrams. Now, here, the first thing I need to do is to substitute all supports with their reactions, in other words, to draw the free body diagram. So here I have a pin support, two reactions, RAY and RAX. Here I have a roller that is pointing upwards, so I will have one support reaction, RBY. And I can see that I have on the beam a UDL as well as a point load over here. So for the UDL, I have to calculate the resultant. Let me just try this over here. The resultant of the UDL is the area of this shape. So this one is a rectangular one. The height of the rectangle is 2 kilonewtons per meter. The base of the rectangle is the whole span over which it applies, which is 3 meters. So this is 2 times 3. This is 6 kilonewtons. Kilonewtons over meter, time meter, it's 6 kilonewtons. Now, this one will be applying at a distance of 1.5 meters from each edge of the beam, because the UDL applies on the whole beam and its whole length is 3 meters. So this is 1.5 meters. Now, having done that, I can apply the equations of equilibrium to calculate the support reactions. Typically, I start with the sum of moments about a convenient point. It would either be A or B. Both options would allow me to calculate one unknown reaction. I selected point A, and I also decide to assume that the moments which are counterclockwise are the positive ones. As I have said a few times before, it will not make any difference in the final result. You should get exactly the same results. But I just did that because it is convenient. The unknown force over here tends to rotate it counterclockwise. So I have this 6 kilonewton resultant that tends to rotate the beam clockwise about point A. So it's a negative 1 minus 6 times 1.5 meters. I have the reaction, which is positive, well, because I have already selected it like that. So plus RBY times the distance, which is 2 meters. And don't forget this 1 kilonewton force, which again tends to rotate it counterclockwise, so minus 1 times 3 meters. And all of them have to sum up to 0. So if I solve for RBY, this will be 9 plus 3, 12. 12 over 2, this is 6 kilonewtons. And as you can see here, it is indeed 6 kilonewtons. But of course, I said that we will be calculating that. Now, you can go to the sum of forces in y direction to calculate RAY. So the sum of forces in y direction has to be equal to 0. RAY points upwards. So RAY minus 6 kilonewtons, which is the resultant of the UDL, plus RBY, which is also 6 kilonewtons, minus 1, which is the force at the end of the overhang. All of them should be 0. So you can see that the 6 and 6 over here, the minus 6, cancel each other out. So RAY has to be 1 kilonewton. Of course, I need to to the sum of forces horizontally as well. So Rax must be zero because there is nothing else over here. Now that I know the support reactions, it is possible to construct the internal forces diagram easily with very few calculations. Let's see how. So let me start with the shear forces. Here I will be drawing the shear forces diagram. As always, please do not forget the units. Now, here, well, I have the typical points. And now, all I need to do is to see what kind of forces apply perpendicular to the axis of the beam. So, first of all, I have this reaction 1 kN. It goes, so let me do it like that. This is 1 kN. At point B, before, a little bit before the point load applies on B, so a bit to the left from point B, I will have this 1 plus the effect of the UDL. Now I can see here that the UDL applies on this 2 meter span, so its resultant will be 2 kN per meter times 2 meters. This is 4 kN. So when I come to point B, from 1 kN, I need to drop down by 4. This means that this will be minus 3 kN. Now, because it is a rectangular UDL, I just use a straight line to connect the 2 points. Well, let's imagine that it is a straight line. Now, here at point B, I see a point load pointing upwards, and it is 6 kN, so from minus 3, I have to go up by 6. So this point over here, I'm just showing that with an arrow to indicate this method. Now, this will be 3 kN, so that the whole change in the shear will be 6. Once again, I have a UDL, which now applies on the part of the beam that is overhanging, so this 1 meter. And the resultant of the UDL is 2 kN per meter times 1 meter. This is 2 kN. This means that a little bit to the left from point C, from 3, I have to drop down by 2 because the UDL points downwards. So the shear force here will be 1 kN. Again, because it is a rectangular UDL, I just connect them with a straight line. Also here, I see that I have a point load, 1 kN, pointing downwards. And this is great because I can see that the diagram closes. It means that it starts from 0 and ends at 0. It is very good because you can use it to assess your working over here. If your diagram does not close at the end, it means that you have done something wrong in your calculations or in your overall working. Don't forget to show which part is positive and which part of the diagram is negative. And this will be all. Much, much faster than performing a section over here, another section over here, another over here, and the last one over here. Now let's go to the moments. So here I will draw the bending moment diagram. Once again, do not forget the units, kilonewton meters. And I start from zero because I don't see any concentrated moment, so it makes sense. All diagrams start from zero. If there was something concentrated here, I would just be having an abrupt change. So it starts from zero, and the next point where I will be calculating the moment will be on point B. Now, to do that, instead of doing the typical kind of calculations that I would do in the method of the sections, I will just calculate the area below the diagram of the shear forces. First of all, I want to point something out over here. You see, the shear forces are positive for a part of the beam and negative for another part. All of that between A and B. This means that up to this point over here, the bending moments will be increasing. So let's say that I will get a value over here. From here to here, they will be decreasing, so they will move upwards, because for the bending moments, let me just show it again, it does no harm. The negative are above the axis and the positive are below the axis, so it will be decreasing. Now, I do not know if it will be negative or positive, so I will just not draw anything, but I know that this will be a positive value. So I need to define this value, but how could I do that? Well, it's not difficult. The value over here is the previous one plus the change in bending moment. So the value over here will be the area of this triangle. But now we have a problem. Well, not that big of a problem because we know the solution, but still a problem. How do we calculate the area when we don't know how much this dimension is? Well, it is possible to calculate this dimension. I will show this here, that we have some space. What we'll do is to use similar triangles and calculate this distance. Now, let me just draw this part of the shear forces diagram. This looks like two triangles that are similar to each other because of the way that they connect to each other. This side is 1 kilonewton, or just one. It's a mathematical problem. And this side is three, well, negative three, but it doesn't really matter because we're talking about triangles here. So three. Now, let me draw a parallel line to this one. It's this one over here. So this whole side will be 3, and because these two lines are parallel, this side will be equal to this one, so this is 1. So the length of this whole side is 4. Let me name the points. Let's say that this one is point A, this one is point B, this one is point C, this one is point D, and this one is point E. Because triangle CDE is similar to triangle ABC, the ratio of side D over C, let me write it like that, over side BA must be equal to the ratio of side CE over CB. Now here I know DC, it's 1. I know BA, it is 4. I know CB, it is 2 meters. So I only have to calculate CE. So if I solve for CE, I find out that this is 0.5 meters, which is great because now I know these dimensions here, which means that I can calculate the area under the graph. So I can calculate the moment without any difficulty. So let me come over here. The moment at this point will be the area of the triangle, which is 1 times 0.5 times, over 2, or times 0.5 again. So this will be, 0.25 kilonewton meters. You don't need to show the units. And here, the area of this triangle is negative 3 times 1.5, which is 4.5, over 2, that is 2.25. So the change in the bending moment from this point to this point will be 2.25, but going negative. So from 0.25, I have to go up by 2.25. So I have to go to 2 kilonewton meters. Well, this is not in scale, but it is still relatively okay. If you want to draw this in scale, you would just move this point up, but it's still fine with us. Now, let me draw with a dashed line straight lines connecting these points. These are not parts of the graph. These are just auxiliary lines. Now, I have a UDL, so it should be a curved line. And because the UDL points downwards, this curved line will be sagging. So it will look something like that. And over here, it will look something like that. Now, from here to here, once again, the change in the bending moment will be the area of this trapezoid. Now, this trapezoid has two parallel sides, one which is 3 and another one which is 1, and its height is the distance from here to here, which, as you can see in the figure, is 1 meter. So the area of the trapezoid will be 3 plus 1, which is 4, times the height, 1, which is still 4, over 2. This is the formula for the area of a trapezoid. So the result is 2 kilonewton meters. This means that from this point to this point, I will need to drop from 2 down to, well, because it's positive, I'm practically adding that. So, but here I'm dropping down by 2 kilonewton meters. So it will have to close to zero, which is great because it means that my working is most probably correct. It's quite unlikely to close if you have done something wrong. It's not impossible, but it's certainly unlikely. So once again, let me just draw with a dashed line this auxiliary straight line. So it has to be curved, and because the UDL points downwards, it has to look like that. So this one is positive, this part is negative, and I have drawn the bending moment diagram. Don't forget to draw the axial forces diagram, because it is the easiest one. Perhaps you could start with this one. I know that everything is zero, so this is the case for this diagram. I hope at this point this method has become more clear to you. Also, I would like you to assess your working. So if we wanted to assess our working here, what we would do is to check whether the moments and the shears are compatible. We can see that here we have positive shears, so the moments are increasing. Here we have negative shears and the moments are decreasing. And here we have positive shears and the moments are increasing again. This means that it is quite likely that we have done everything correctly, together of course with the fact that all diagrams closed without any effort. So that will be all with this question. I hope this method seems much easier. And as I said, whether or not you can do this quite fast and using this method in the exam depends on whether or not you will be required to apply a specific method. If there is no restriction, feel free to do that and I will be happy.